trying to develop a senior residence facilities in Jaffna to promote wellness and green living.
Perfect. We have Satya here. She or he, there's no camera. Satya, you can go ahead.
Hello, sir. I'm Satya. I'm from Allied Health Science. I'm a lecturer in probationary in pharmacy.
Perfect. Can you switch on your video if you like it?
Yeah, okay.
And Shari, yes.
Hi. I'm sorry, I haven't got video. I'm just trying to save my battery power. I'm Sharani, speaking from London. I'm an accountant by trade, and my family originate from Nallur. So I'm joining the call to just hear if I could help and contribute in any way.
Perfect. Thank you, Sherry. Uday Bhaskar?
Yes, sir. Good evening to you. Good morning to you and good evening to the rest of the members. I'm Uday Bhaskar, marine engineer by profession, work on board ship, look after the running and maintenance of onboard machinery. So joining from Chennai, and I'm a classmate of Mr. Madhimagan and close friend of him.
Okay. Thank you, sir. We have our well-known Dr. Surendirakumar. No introduction needed, but you know. Dr. Surendirakumar?
Mute. This is thank you, Varagunan. This is Dr. Surendirakumar. I am attached to Department of Community and Family Medicine, Faculty of Medicine, University of Jaffna. Thank you.
And Mr. Jehan?
Okay, hello. I'm Chagan Araya. I spent most of my life in the UK, but for the last 5 years, I've been based out of Jaffna, where I'm encouraging entrepreneurs, mentoring, encouraging entrepreneurs, and doing some work with English language, promoting English language.
Thank you, Jehan. Arivu?
I'm Arivu Lahan. Attached to the Department of Mathematics and Statistics, University of Jaffna.
Perfect. And Pupala Sundaram?
I'm Angiral. I'm attached to the Chemistry Department.
I think we heard from Renuka, I believe. Renuka Sundaraja?
Yeah, I introduced myself a bit earlier,
yes.
But I'm Dr. Rita Sunaraja, and I'm a scientist. So I worked in Jaffna for the last 2.5 years. Just came back a day ago. And I help set up heart manufacturing and doing some other work as well.
Okay. And Mr. Pubala Sundaram.
Yeah, I'm angry and I'm being second time.
I think this is getting...
You are going, Varagunan, you are going back and introducing.
Okay. Mrs. Wilson, Shanti Wilson. You have to unmute yourself.
Sorry about that. Hello, everybody. I'm based in Colombo. I was attached to the Industrial Technology Institute as additional director of research. I'm now retired. I'm a post-harvest biologist.
And the Purnima?
Good evening, and to you in Canada, Norway, and. Hello.
Yes, we can hear you.
Good evening to people all around the world, and good morning to you. And I'm Purnima, and I've been living. I'm right now based in Chennai, Tamil Nadu, and I've been living outside India for the past 4 years. I've returned back to India, and I'm basically working with maritime industry.
Thank you, Purnima. Next is Mr. Vinu Mendes.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Lasanta Mendes. I'm microfinance specialist by profession. I also champion civil movement by the name of Avankal Anka. You can check me out on www.avankalanka.org. I'll set it on the chat. And I also have a special love for Jaffna and my Facebook, which is Lasanta Mendes, has a group called Love Jaffna. So you can, at your leisure, see how what we do, and we can link up later. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Lasanta. Devi Sabodharan.
Yes, sir. Hi. Hi, everyone. I am Mrs. Sabodharan, attached to Nursing Department, Allied Health Sciences, University of Jaffna.
Excellent. Thank you, Dr. Mrs. Sabodharan. Devi Janakar.
Yes.
Go ahead, Devi.
I am a senior.
Devi Janakar.
Yes, I am here. Hello.
Yes, go ahead. We can hear you.
Yes. From Faculty of Allied Sciences.
Okay. Yaneswaran.
I'm Yaneswaran. I will live in Markham, close to Uxbridge.
Oh, so, hi.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm a retired civil engineer.
Okay.
I just got the invitation from Niranjan, so I am here to say hello to everyone. Thank you.
Oh, another Canadian. Okay. Jay.
Yeah. Great. I'm here, Balakitan Jay Krishna. Greetings to all of you. I'm a lecturer attached to the Department of Medical Laboratory Sciences, University of Jaffna. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you. Suresh Kumar. Amazing. Suresh Kumar.
I am Suresh Kumar. I work for Bharat Heavy Electricals. I am from Bellu. I am a batchmate of Mr. Madhimagan and Dayalan and Uday Bhaskar.
That is Kanjipuram Engineering College.
I am a mechanical engineer by profession.
Okay.
Presently heading the commercial department of BHEL, Bharat Heavy Electricals Limited, Ranipet.
Perfect. Thank you, Suresh Kumar. Manoj?
Yes, I'm Manoj. I'm joining from Colombo. I'm attached to the Faculty of Medicine, Colombo. I'm a professor in community medicine. And
perfect.
I've been associated with Niranjan maybe about 14 years now.
Excellent. And Dr. Dwarakan?
Yes, I'm Dwarakan, attached to Department of Pharmacy, senior lecturer, Faculty of Allied Health Science, University of Jaffna.
Perfect. And Sivakumar Subramanian?
Yeah, I am Dr. Sivakumar from Faculty of Engineering, University of Jaffna.
Perfect. So we have few other people here. I mean, it's all jumbled now. Dinesh Kunge? So we'll wait. Uma Indran. Hi, Uma.
Yes, hello. I'm Uma Indran. I live in the UK. I'm a chartered management accountant. I work at strategic and operational levels, and I've got experience across a wide range of industry sectors, including healthcare, technology, and business services. And I'm here because I like to see if there's any interesting business opportunities.
Thank you. Dr. Isra Mohan.
Yes. I am Thambu Iswara Mohan, attached to Department of Zoology as a senior lecturer at the University of Jaffna. And I'm quite interested in entrepreneur business linkage as well. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Seduparan.
I'm Sri Seduparan. I attach with the Advanced Technological Institute as a senior lecturer. The, my field is IT.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Jeeva Perumal Pillai.
Yes, hi, I'm Jeeva Perumapilla SX. I'm a World Bank retiree, an economist, living mostly in Sri Lanka, but currently in London.
Excellent. Did we actually introduce Siva Thayalan?
No, I'm Thayalan, Madhi's batchmate. I'm from Jaffna. At the moment, I'm in Saudi Arabia working as a consultant for Saudi Arabia.
Wow. Okay, great. I think we have 15 minutes gone or 20 minutes gone of introduction. We will introduce when people join, if that's okay. So if you can mute all your microphones, that'll be helpful. So just a quick introduction of what's going to happen today. It's perfectly a knowledge share. We have people from Canada, UK, Saudi Arabia, India, and Sri Lanka, five different countries. What we're going to do is, I know it's very hard to compare, each and every country is different, and but this is a learning process. We have to learn from others. We can learn from others' success, and we also can learn from others' mistakes. So let me quickly introduce myself. I'm Varagunan. I'm in Canada, near Oxbridge. I'm a GP. We call it family physicians here. I also work in the emergency department once in a while, slowly retracting from emergency. And I'm also the president of the International Medical Health Organization, IMHO Canada, which, you know, we do a lot of projects in Sri Lanka. All right, I think let's start with the ground reality from Dr. Surendran. Dr. Surendran, would you kindly start with the situation in Jaffna about the COVID-19? Your mic is on mute.
Yeah. Thank you, Varagunan. I'm sharing that slide which I have prepared. It's not a very long presentation. I know this maybe for 5 minutes, but that I want to share that I'm trying. Is it? Oh, okay. I want to share this, what have happened in Sri Lanka, and then Professor Manoj also available from Department of Community Medicine, University of Colombo, and also he can update a little bit more about what is happening in Sri Lanka. So I have divided that into three phases. That in the early stage, and then what things are going on, and the future. So early stage, we started with the mid of March, this lockdown, and then imposed this curfew. Because that purpose is our strategy, particularly Sri Lankan strategy, is to not to allow the virus to get into the community. So then particularly that quarantine process started from airport, and then check the people, and then initially only that we had the fever surveillance, but later after spreading to the European and the North American countries, and our strategy changed, and we started this quarantine center. So quarantine all these air travelers were taken to the quarantine centers. So then they kept in the quarantine center and isolated, and also we started to find out the people even not taken to the quarantine center. So particularly came after February, mid of February. So we were able to trace all the people, because the Sri Lanka has a very good public health system. So that is the success for most of these elimination of malaria, then the polio, and also even now that filaria and all. So then we have a very good public health network started in early 40s and 50s. So we could able to trace with these public health inspectors and MOH system. And also we got this quite helpful from the triforces, just with the armed forces. So then it's easy for us to trace and then keep the people at the isolation. The isolation at two different levels. Isolation was at the household level and then isolation at the quarantine centers. So, but particularly what I'm talking here, there were a few active clusters in the country and still we have two or three active clusters in the country. From there that we are getting cases. The clusters mean that when the particularly that infectious disease, when we get this first point case, from that case the people get the infection, then there we will get the clusters. So particularly for the northern province, we got only one cluster that is related to that one of the religious activity and the entity, and then and the person came for that program actually with the virus. So that's what then other people, those who had a very good that they were with them, and then thing then we were in the problem was we heard about this only after 5 days after the event, but that we couldn't get the information, proper information, who were the participants, and where are they from, and then now where are they living, and all these things. But fortunately, this our people all helped. So initially we got only the information about 14 people, then finally we were able to trace and find out around 347 people related to that event, including family members. So then out of that, we found around 20 people have very, like, actually a close contact. Then they had a very close contact, and they were actually isolated and kept in a different quarantine place. But others put it in the house, and we locked down the areas. So there are two areas locked down in. Actually, locked down mean that village people are kept in. They didn't allow to go out. So then we put these barriers, and then security officers and all. Then we were providing all the food and other supplies, and then they were not allowed to go out. So even curfew during some of the time that when they lift the curfew also, we didn't allow them to go out even for their things. So all essential items were provided for them when they are in the lockdown area. So then after keeping all this lockdown and all house isolation, but we need to have a laboratory testing. So for the our country, particularly Sri Lanka, we have only 4 virologists, and then this PCR facility is very limited. So then our samples, particularly northern province and northern central samples, were sent to Anuradhapura. So the Anuradhapura was doing all the sample. So then there was a delay, and then getting maybe 1 or 2 days to get the results. Then that time that we tried to develop a laboratory, and we got to know then one PCR machine at the hospital and another one in the faculty. Faculty one is actually brought it for the research purpose. So then with the support of Ministry of Health and Sri Lanka, then we were able to develop and make it functional at the faculty level. So the faculty laboratory things started to work. So that is very good support actually for us to test more people. Earlier we were testing only 10 to 15 samples. Now it's actually increased the capacity to 40 to 50 samples per day. So then we were able to do this testing of the people at the quarantine center. The 20 people were in the quarantine center from that particular cluster. So out of 20, initially we got first day the 3 positive and following day another 3 positive. Then we did that again because you know this test sensitivity is 70%. So then we thought that maybe we may miss some other people, and we repeated again after 6-7 days. Then we got another 6 and another 10 positive. So out of that, so that from that cluster, Jaffna got 17 cases. So we got one patient before we kept them in the isolation. We got one case, that case immediately, and also this is Sri Lanka adopted that mechanism. Whenever the people get the positive, we don't keep them in the houses, and immediately they are taken to the IDH, infection disease hospital, infectious disease hospital. And so IDHs, because of this small number, then our hospitals also able to manage with these whoever positive, and immediately they are transferred to the hospital. So then it's easy for us to manage in one place. So these all helped us to actually not to get into the that fourth stage that WHO mentioning first, second, third, fourth, say fourth stage is going to the community. So most of these European and other countries had the experience of North America and all America. So our thing, so still we are able to see that when the when one case is positive, we know the where that case is, case probably get the virus. So then we could able to trace that. So that is the still we could able to do that. That is the positive thing. So if there's more information out that in now the southern part that's going on, maybe later on from Manoj can update. So these are the things that we did in early stage. Then at the moment what we have a problem, now we don't have any active cases in Jaffna or even in Northern Province, and we checked all the quarantine people and also then other people kept in the house quarantine also tested and then negative, and we actually all are now allowed to go for this normal life, and we ensured, and also now we are quite sure because this happened about 45 to 50 days back. So the now we passed this 3 incubation period, because in the average incubation period what this virus as mentioned by WHO is 14 days, but there are chances of getting things even after that. But that when we look at this average 14, now we have passed at least 14 days, and still we didn't have any positive cases, reported positive cases. But now we have the problem, some other people also, then we introduce this pass system for the people, those who are going outside the district. So then they need to go to the government agent and also to the area MOH, both should clear. And also we should know then this, who are the people going out of these districts. So now we have all the information, who are the people going outside districts, particularly to Colombo and other suburbs, because these active things are going on there. So then when they are coming back, then we could able to test them and put under, keep them under surveillance. Even one person is positive, then we could able to trace. But in between, we got few people coming, actually coming and going. Both things are happening, that like regular, that's illegal things. And also we are able to identify around nine people, that those came from Colombo, particularly that area which that things are happening around Kesalvata and then Peliagoda and all these areas, and we kept them in the quarantine, and also we checked them. So now that surveillance, actually most of you would have heard about this word surveillance. The surveillance is came from military, so the surveillance is the key, particularly in the public health and for the disease control. Usually we when we teach these students, we tell that military deal with the enemy that he can visible to the normal eye, but our enemy is not visible to normal eye, so the viruses and bacteria. So then now we are working. So surveillance mechanism is very important. So then the public as a key people, because that people when they are coming, and also we have some other issues with these regular migration between India and Sri Lanka, particularly the northern part. That kind of activities are very easy. Then now that India, that some other part of India, the community transmission is going on, so then we must be very vigilant. So then surveillance is very important. That our challenge is public education, that the behavioral change still very difficult for the people to maintain the social distancing and not to and using this soap and sanitizers for this hand washing, and then there are controversial things about using masks. So those are the issues still we have, a big thing. Then we need to find out different methods and innovations to change the behavior, because we have to live with this virus. So and also we need these innovations, particularly when we are promoting hand washing, and then this thing, we need to have a locally available, affordable things for the public, no ordinary public to use. And also this northern province, particularly we have, all of you know, and this is most of these districts, particularly Klimachi, Mullathivu, are the most affected economically, and then the poverty level very high. So this most of the districts in northern province, and northern province is the one top in the poverty, or maybe the Uwa or northern, that the things. So northeast and Uwa are the provinces really poverty affected. So then it's again, it's like a vicious cycle is going on. Then this virus is promoting more, then people are going to have more malnutrition and all these issues. So then it's very important at the moment that we people are motivated and mobilizing and providing kind of a food ration and all these things, but that we need to see how we are going to thrive this local economy. That is one thing that when we are really talking. So then future, we all need agree that we need to live with the COVID-19. So this is my personal thing, Now this virus is all over the, everywhere. So it will be like an influenza. So then virus also will try to reduce its virulence and try to live with us. So we need to live with like influenza. So periodically we will get this COVID infection, that coronavirus infection, maybe in different form. And then sometimes it mutates and we may get another pandemic. So this is going to be with us. But we don't know how we are going to do our economic and social activities. Particularly, we need to run our schools, education institutions, and then markets, and then the big businesses and all this, and also recreation facilities. So how we are going to do it is a thing. So we need to go for a new world order, and then how we are going to do it, and how we are going to change our community. Then people can talk about vaccine, but still very difficult. And we know this very good. We don't have a very good vaccine for the influenza. So then, to what extent that vaccine is going to help us is still questionable. So then, the future challenge for us, we need to change the behavior of the people. How we are going to mobilize the needed resources, particularly we are talking about this, even WHO is talking this stuff, improve the supply chains and all. And then there are kind of partnerships and innovation and research thing. And even a couple of days back, WHO signed this agreement with the European Investment Bank to improve these research and other activities. So we don't know how things are, but that we need to know how to mobilize to countries, and then countries like Sri Lanka is still developing and then having economical issues, and also this particularly northern province and after this protracted conflict and recovering from that, and how we are going to ensure that, and all these things are questionable. And then how we are going to improve this coverage. Then when we are talking about education, now people are talking online teaching learning, and then how many people actually really have the access, and how many people have the internet facilities, whether our internet things can think that now even Zoom, that we got it for the universities through the Learn project, but they got it only for 10,000. Now they have over 35,000 people are subscribing, then it's oversubscribed, then they are not able to provide that good services. So then also schools, now we recently these UIL results came out, and again that northern province is the ninth province, okay, in compared to all other provinces. So then last year it was eighth, so the competition between the east and the north. And also then now even these people come, students coming from poor family background, studying in the grade 9, 10 and 11 because of this school closure for more than a few months, and that may affect them to change their mind to follow the education. So we are going to get a lot of dropouts in these classes, particularly grade 10 and 11. And how are we going to motivate them and catch up them to get into the school, and all these things are big thing. And how we are going to develop this global partnership. So these are the things that I am posing this for you to discuss and get things, and maybe it can help us to work further. Thank you for the opportunity.
You can stop sharing the screen now, Dr. Surendran.
Yes.
So that was an excellent presentation, Dr. Surendirakumar. As usual, you know, you brought up lots of issues here and the current situation here. Thank you so much, Dr. Surendirakumar. I've known Dr. Surendirakumar for a long time. He's an excellent professor and he's great with the students, very popular. And he's brought up lots of issues here, medical issues, cultural issues, you know, economic issues and the future. I think these are all the questions in all our mind. Do we have anybody to comment or a question to Dr. Surendirakumar You can go ahead. I'm going to unmute everyone now.
I'm Yaneswaran. Can we have this presentation somewhere in the common forum? Because it was very good, and we need something like that for us to go forward. So if it is available for our use, then it would be really appreciated.
Sure. I think you can share it with the email or a WhatsApp group, Dr. Surendra, and that'll be great. One thing he raised about the O-level results, there's a joke going around, like the Northern Province was pretty lax. Jaffna was some 20 seconds. So that means you're going to get more entrepreneurs now than having doctors and scientists and engineers. It's a good sign, maybe. That's what people say. Yeah.
Yes, I was also thinking.
Rather than bookworms and going into A-levels and becoming doctors, engineers and lawyers, we'll be having more entrepreneurs, and it looks very bright. I mean, this is just a passing remark.
Yes, no. I was also thinking the same, because people who are one way inclined will come back to it because they'll get bored with doing other things and they will get back to the mainstream. People who are very good on craftsmanship will want to follow a more practical sort of career.
Yes. So it'll open up. Raja, you wanted to say something, sorry.
I just have a student. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Your signals are weak.
I was wondering how you actually monitor people who come back to the Northern Province, but you know, people who transport goods and so on. It's just that we came with a person, because I'm now in London, and they get a pass. When they come back, how do you monitor them? What are the procedures?
That's a good question. That the people, those who are coming at the moment, we don't have any vehicles, at least the Jaffna is very easy. And then we have this problem, and now we ask this Jaffna GA to contact this elephant pass. And then the elephant pass is registering the people. So Vaunia also same thing. So then we have this registering mechanism. So all these relevant government agents are getting that who are the people coming from the checkpoints. So then we could able to monitor. So that is the mechanism now we are following.
Great. I have a question to you, Dr. Surendirakumar. In Sri Lanka, what is the criteria for somebody to get tested for COVID-19?
Yeah, that's Manoj is good person to tell, but that I can also Manoj can help me. This depends on things. That criteria are developed by the epidemiology unit that. So then people that initial criteria was like having contact history and the symptom. So, or maybe and then unexplained pneumonia, then people are coming to the institutions. But at the moment, what are these, some of the criteria what we are adopting for the surveillance is different. So then we are doing that people, those who have a potential risk, and also we are testing. So then we want to have it this like surveillance, see whether these any infection is going in the community. So for that we have to adapting and look at this situation. Depends on then we are doing with risk groups. So then we feel with those who are the high risk group, then we are doing the testing. So there are two types of things are going on. One thing is that patients coming to the hospital or maybe suspects and then identified. So they had that what you are doing in Canada and other countries and with that criteria. So another criteria we are doing and to test this prevent the cases to not live in the community and also not prevent the spread, prevent of the infection in the community. So then we do that surveillance screening and then see whether there's a virus level in the community.
Great, thank you. there was a question asked that, you know, whenever you have a person with symptom and positive, you actually push them into the quarantine center. People are asking whether is that going to give any benefits, or are they going to infect, even say somebody who is negative COVID-19, go into that particular center and they're going to get infected. Like keeping all these positive people together, is it a good idea or not? Can you answer that? I think there are epidemiologists here.
Yeah, that's a good question, Varagunan. Now that we got these 20 people, and out of within 20 people, there were questions whether they there are cross infection or anything. But you know, these we selected these 20, the most probable, highly possible contacts. That's those who can develop further disease. So then, when we are putting them in the quarantine, most of the time that they try to maintain all the things. But when people are using some other mobile phones and things, maybe sharing, those issues are there when they are in the quarantine. But good point of thing, if we allow them to live in the house, then the problem is they can, at the household level, it's so difficult for us to monitor whether they are staying always in the isolated separate room. And also, you know, this in our houses, we don't have any separate toilets and all these facilities. So there are more chances for the people to spread, and then the leak from the houses to other houses. So that's why the quarantine centers are good. And also, we are not taking this all the symptomatic people. We see the possible probable contacts. So now, out of that, now then, from the Kesalwath, there are about 1,200 people. But out of that, so far we have not received any symptom. But we keep all these people separately and monitor them. So that is helpful to spread these communities. And we know these people are the vulnerable, and we check them also. Then we totally test them, and then only we are sending out of the houses. So when we are having at the houses, maybe even Singapore, they try to keep them and then track them through the mobile phones, but still then they couldn't do it. And there are a lot of issues and leakages, and then they got so many cases. So that's why these quarantine centers, but the problem is we don't have an ideal places. Ideally, we need to have a separate room with separate bathroom and all, and then food must be given by these people separately and all these things. Most of the places, they try that their best with the available resources. So then we are not all these places, because we can't put them in the hotels. So if you can put, very good thing is put them in the hotels. So the hotels, they won't give it, because when they want to start this economic thing, and then they won't give it to this kind of quarantine. So the quarantine things are most of the time, it's happening in the camps and other areas. Then again, another problem, you know, these people, some of the time they escape from the quarantine centers. So then we have to have them very secure places. Otherwise, then these people, dangerous people, may go out and things. So there is a good film and to watch this after this. I think SARS. They developed that film, Contagion. So Contagion film. So that even that's advised by the famous virologist. So they. So even from the quarantine place, one person escaped, and that person went to the this one. I think that is going on in California. So California, then state, and that person spread that disease. So that kind of dangerous things are there when we have a when we don't have them in the proper quarantine, also without any secure and all these isolation and the security support. So then all these things and there are problems. But for our knowledge, it's best part is we have to maintain this kind of thing.
Great, Dr. Surendirakumar.
I want to add one or two points here.
Yes.
Quarantine now this jet green blue and Centara seasons, they are allowing their hotels to be function as quarantine centers, and they are charging 7,500 per. And those who are returning from London and Australia, the particular the Sri Lankan students, Sri Lankan Airlines is running and they are returning, and they are preferred to stay in those hotels. This is information I got it from yesterday. Thank you.
Thank you, Madhi Mahan. Just a quick note here. I want to mute everyone. Hello. Right. So thank you so much, Madhi Mahan and Dr. Surendran. I think Sri Lanka, what I'm looking at here is 705 cases and 7 deaths. Is that right, the numbers?
Yeah. So, numbers are right.
7 deaths. That is amazing. I mean, I think more people die of motor vehicle accidents in Sri Lanka than COVID-19. I mean, we cannot compare these two, but more people die of other causes every year. Now, about the thing, what I just want to share something about Canada. If somebody is returning from Canada, they have to present a concrete plan of isolation. If not, the government will take them to a hotel and they will be provided with every facility. It's free. And, you know, they will be staying there for 14 days. If they don't have symptoms, they can go back home. Again, comparing Canada and Sri Lanka is the ridiculous thing we can ever do, because Sri Lanka is one of the small countries by landmass with the same population as Canada. Canada is the second largest country in the world with the largest border, land border with the USA. Very unfortunately, USA has crossed 66,000 men and women like me and you. I mean, it's numbers we are looking at, but just imagine 66,000 people. But unfortunately, I don't want to go get into politics. Nobody is talking about. They are just worried about their economy and all that. Let's not go there. Canada, we are very fortunate. Today, we have 57,148 cases positive, and 3,656 people have died. Many of them are extreme seniors and vulnerable population. Thanks to the Canadian system, is so different. The healthcare system is so different from the Sri Lankan or the British system or the Norwegian. We have only one tier system. It's the public health system. So nobody pays here. Everything is free. So you don't need to worry about how you're going to spend the money on this and all that. But 3,656 deaths is a good number according to the statistics, because we have every year at least 3,000 to 4,000 people die of influenza every year. So, I mean, 3,600 human beings have died is a very sad thing. But I think according to today's report from Public Health Canada, we are trying to flatten the curve, and we are very cautious. They are slowly opening things. The schools are not going to open for this term until September. But I have a question here for, I mean, we have a great audience here, lots of professionals here. If somebody can answer me this question, I saw some of the videos in Sri Lanka and India. They are spraying antiseptics in cars and tires and even people. Has any studies been done whether these are effective? I think these are very poisonous substances they are spraying on people and cars and houses. Are they useful in containing these virus or not? I mean, if anybody can answer, that will be great. Hello.
Sir, I'm Suresh Kumar. Actually, they are spraying Lysol, 10% Lysol diluted. 10% diluted Lysol they are spraying. there is it is some sort of they are not it is being advised, but it is not proven whether it is effective or not. But see, something is better than nothing. It's like people want to be slightly cautious, and wherever common places where people get used to move, those like public places, and they are being sprayed with 10% Lysol, diluted Lysol.
I understand, so but I mean, cleaning with Lysol in common spaces and all that is being studies being done. That is okay, but spraying on people and cars, has anybody done any research? I think Sri Lanka also, they are doing it.
No. So Sri Lanka, actually, we had a problem, Varagunan. This is Surendirakumar.
Yes.
These people, some of the places, particularly, they started to do that. But that we stopped that. Even in Vaunia, some of the checkpoints that they started, and then later on, that they are using actually hydrochloric. They use this 1% here that we all use this 0.1%. It's not even 1%, no, 0.5%. Usually, this is not of? In 1 in 100. It's we are using 1,000.
Of what?
Hypochlorine. Hypochlorine.
Bleach. Yes. Okay.
Bleach. That is 0.1%. They are spraying most of these environment. They want these even tables and even floors and all these areas. But that to the people, earlier people suggested, but this started, I think, from Middle East, you know, and then some of the places, and they found, and even airports that they were doing, but it's not a good thing, as you said. And then even Sri Lanka, some of the people suggested even start in the airport, and they stopped. They didn't allow. So there's no any scientific or any proof that will work. But the spraying to the environment, particularly in the possible contact areas, so we suspect that whether that people are coming. So all these places, people are doing spraying this hypochlorine.
I know it can be a good thing for your mental health. Oh, I'm happy that something is sprayed, but this 0.1% of bleach, is it viricidal by scientific methods?
Yeah, this is actually recommended by the WHO after this this flu, that this avian influenza and this. So they said that it's effective for the influenza, and they are using that for the environment thing. But we, for the COVID-19, still we don't have the evidence now. That there are only 2 papers published so far about the environment, for my knowledge. And the one is simulated thing. They are comparing the SARS and the COVID-19. How many days that this virus can survive in the environment. So then maybe in the table, papers, toilets and all. And also then you know that there are fecal shedding of the virus also there. So that's why there's people using this thing. This is all from the WHO, even CDC thing. They have just said that US is planning them, then that the Environmental Protection Agency, they have made this. What are the chemicals that could be used to this? But particularly, your point is correct, because Sri Lanka, still we don't have a community spread and the community wire. But that people are scared, even a person maybe not detected, maybe moving around, then can get it. So then we are some overreacting. But India, of course, now, this, as I said, this community transmission is going on. Even in Madras, they were around 35, 40 cases per day, like that, they are getting community transmission. So then definitely they need to use that, I think. That's
great.
My...
Thank you. Yeah, thanks, Dr. Surendirakumar. One more question. Maybe it's a bad question or stupid question. We read every day that in Sri Lanka, many people get arrested because they violated the curfews. So I think yesterday about 571. Where are these people kept? Are they kept in prison? Are they kept in close contacts? I mean, so they're going to spread to each other, the arrested people. What is happening? Can you shed some light on that?
No, they arrest and then, again, I don't know that whether you heard about the news, they arrested immediately, released them. So they only put this FIR and they then charge them. But that they won't take, even then most of the people, still they didn't take them to a court. So then after taking them to the court only, then they can find whether they are going to fine it or what sort of action they are going to take it. But this all already police charged.
My name is Vasu. They charge them and they give a date to appear in the court, providing it's possible to appear.
Okay. No, it's just a question. I mean, it's, I know it's, I always think, where are these people kept? Is in a jail or something? Here also in Canada, the fines are very steep fines. We had people being fined playing cricket. People are having parties with their family members, they're fined. I think they're tracking the cell phone things. And if three cars are parked, then you're fined very steeply. And because it's easy to identify people here because everybody has identification here. And I think even Sri Lanka, everybody carries an identification card. Recently, if you must have seen a video on the social media, there is like the 50th birthday is being celebrated, some cars going around a house. It's a Tamil 50th birthday. You know, we do, our Canadian Tamils, we love to do crazy things. So now, yesterday, the government said, not more than three cars you can go in a parade. So lots of things here because, I mean, really appreciate the Sri Lankan doctors and the frontline workers and the armed forces by implementing things. It's very difficult here. Even yesterday, 100 people protested to open the economy in Canada. And they were standing very close and everybody was given a fine or something. I think in Sri Lanka, at least that fear psychosis works better on the, I mean, you can see the numbers. Anybody from the UK about what's happening in UK?
Well, in the UK, they want to take a democratic. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. All right. In the UK, they tend to be very democratic about it, and they think they want to use the soft approach. The police officers just walk up to them and sort of question why they are there and nudge them towards better behavior. So that's about it. They don't go into drastic because there will be a huge public protest otherwise. So that's in a nutshell.
I think UK, it's about 28,000 has died so far, unfortunately.
Yes. Anyway. Don't know today's count. Yeah.
Yeah. So let's shift this a little bit on the other side. I mean, this is a knowledge share. So we're not finding fault or we're not finding anything. We are just learning from each other what's happening in the world. Canada, one thing, it's easy to manage things here because the rich and poor gap is very, very less. So you have really stinking rich or stinking poor, very few people, but most of them fall in that middle line. Whereas in countries like Sri Lanka, there are extreme rich and extreme poor, and there is the middle class. I think there comes the issue with economy and medical services and all that comes very hard to maintain. So getting back to the COVID-19, who gets into the hospital and who doesn't go into the hospital? In Canada, if you are symptomatic and you are otherwise healthy, people are instructed to call family doctor. So I'm a family doctor. And what happens is we have four doctors in our office. We take turns and go to our office because not all four of us want to get exposed. And if you are exposed to a COVID-19 patient, you are supposed to be quarantined 14 days, self-quarantined. So we take turns, but we do a lot of phone calls, consultation, and Zoom video consultation with the patient. They're very happy about that. So the first thing is you call, a patient calls me this morning and said, doctor, I have a little short of breath and a fever. What should I do? Should I go to the emergency department? Should I get tested? So the answer for that is, if I know this patient very well because we have all their charts in our computer. So I told the patient, he's a healthy 25-year-old, quarantine yourself, a separate room. This is like when I was a kid growing up in Colombo and studying at Royal College, when I had chicken pox, I was pushed into a room and my mother used to bring the, the tapada and put it under the door. And we say hi and we read a book and, you know, after the chicken pox gone. That's the same thing we are telling people. You don't need to get checked. So the symptoms are, you are COVID positive unless otherwise it's proved. That's the approach. If somebody is really sick, the fever is not coming down, they are feeling shortness of breath, underlying condition, diabetes, asthma, any chemotherapy, these people needs to go to the hospital. And they are welcomed at the hospital and they are not put in the life support right away. They are monitored in a separate floor or a ward called COVID floor, and they are tested for positive. Any frontline worker, that means it could be doctor, nurses, personal support workers, pharmacists, paramedics, grocery store, people working in the grocery stores, policemen, fire, ambulance, everybody, they are given priority to test because they can spread it. And if any frontline worker found that they have a fever, they will be quarantined immediately. Thank goodness there is a lot. I mean, I know there are lots of educated people in everywhere and lots of idiots in every country. I think Canada, we have less of idiots and lots of understanding people. We are fortunate about that. Sorry for the language. But so we are supposed, if a frontline worker says that I have a fever, he quarantines himself and he's fully paid and covered. He doesn't need to worry that he has to go because his earning is going to stop. So that is the criteria in Canada. Anybody wants to step in here, please?
Can you follow it in Sri Lanka?
Yeah.
I have a question.
Yes.
I want a real expert medical opinion on this. What do you really think of herd immunity?
Dr. Surendirakumar is the best person to answer, the public health person.
No, that herd immunity means, actually, when we get the vaccine, most of the people, particularly in Sri Lanka, the vaccine coverage is very high. So vaccine coverage is, this depends on the different diseases. When we take simple example is measles. So measles virus is a highly contagious. That the Varagunan was telling that when he was small and then kept his isolation, and then mother brought this, and these are common things. So people get. So now we have a vaccine. So we have a vaccine to eliminate. Right, then Sri Lanka measles coverage is somewhere around 99%. That means still we have people, 1% without vaccine. That the vaccine means they don't have any that memory cell or antibody to protect from measles. So because of this 99%, the 1% also won't get the measles. That's what we are telling, this herd immunity. So when we have people infected in a certain level in the community, because of these people having that antibody in their body reach certain level, because of that, other people won't get the disease. So then still London City, they get the measles, children with the measles, because their coverage is less than 94%. That we need to have a 95% coverage, more than 95% coverage when we prevent this development of measles. So there's a measles coverage, that vaccine coverage is less than 90% in London. Because of that, there are children more prone to get the measles. So here, that means people, those who are developed antibody and protection, preventing some of the people in the population not to get the disease. That's how that is happening, because they are breaking the transmission chain. So virus should go from one person to another person, then another person to another person. So when the virus is there, if the virus can't go to this from one person to another person, because the person is immune, already got the vaccine, or got, because of the disease the person developed, so then virus can't spread out. So that is the theory. So then when population is, when we have a 90% of the population is having antibody, then the virus to transmit in the population is very difficult for the virus to transmit. So that's why that this immunity is coming. That is what we call it, herd immunity. Is it clear?
Very clear. Yeah. But is it 90 or 95%? What percentage is it? 90 or 95%?
No, that is different for virus to virus, and its level of contagious. So even SARS, you know, the SARS, Merck, and then COVID. So SARS, even we didn't have this kind of things, because the attachment and way that spread is different. And then Merck was different. But they were high fatality rate, but low contagious. But COVID is highly contagious, but fatality rate is comparatively lower than lowest. Yeah. Than the Middle East respiratory syndrome virus, and then the severe acute respiratory syndrome. So different virus, and even this virus, so far they have found around there are 4 mutations in this virus after even from the Wuhan, that original thing. So the virus also that change, adapt, and this. So then we don't know really how many percentage the population should get it. And most of the time it should be more than 70-80%. So that is very difficult to get at the moment, and because that's what they are doing, this antibody testing. In US, most of the districts, they couldn't reach. No, it's still they are in 20-25%. So that's very difficult to reach that herd immunity for COVID-19. That's what that earlier UK was planning, to let the people to develop immunity, herd immunity. And now also they are actually Oxford-led research thing they are planning, to see how many percentage of the population develop that. But I don't know how, what extent that is going to help us. Still, we don't have enough knowledge.
Excuse me, can I just interrupt and ask? Antibodies, yes. In the UK, they say they can't do the antibody test because there is no reliable testing at the moment. What would your thoughts be?
That's really true. Because it's so new, and you know, these tests and research takes a long time to really give good answers. My take on the herd immunity is the COVID virus, it's a coronavirus, it's type of a coronavirus, where this common cold also is a similar virus like the COVID-19. So for common cold, there is no vaccine because it doesn't produce that much damage. So people, I don't think they bother to get a vaccine, and there is no herd immunity. We get common cold every year. And same thing with influenza. We have to develop a vaccine for influenza. Herd immunity is very less. So the scientists right now are not sure the COVID-19, we could actually use the herd immunity. It is not at all clear, and it doesn't look good in that context. Am I right, Dr. Surendirakumar?
Yeah, actually that you are exactly right. And then the diagnosis, it's a good question. Now we are relying on the PCR, right? Because we need to identify the virus, because this antibody to people develop antibody, so they will develop only after symptom, developing symptom, it's maybe around 3 to that IgM early, and then 3 to 10 days. So then IgM, IgG, But that again, as Dr. Varagunan said, that their sensitivity, you know, that sensitivity and specificity that we, the things that we use, the sensitivity mean the test ability of the test to detect a person has a positive result as a positive, the sensitivity. And the specificity means when the test ability of the test, when the person doesn't have the disease as a negative. So then even this PCR test at the moment, what we are using, the sensitivity is 60 to 70%. The 70% means when we test 100 positive, the test positive, we will get only 70. So we may miss 30 positive cases. Even we will get as a negative. But this test has a 100% specificity. That means it will say when we take 100% non-disease people, it will say they are no disease. So this test that we may miss 30 people positive. So that's why that we need to repeat it. So we don't know about the antibody testing kits that are available. It's very early for us. Even then we have only experience in China and Korea, that particularly they are the people. This now only now then Italy, France and German, then UK, US, things are coming up. So studies are coming up. Even this publication, most of the things coming out from all these researcher, not peer reviewed, and most of the publications coming out immediately, and journals are also eager to publish that evidence. People are waiting. So there are a lot of things. So as when we talk about this, like what WHO is saying, we have only the virus, 3 month old virus. So we know a few things about this virus. So we have to wait for more information. But antibody test only useful. That's what that a lot of people were thinking. When we people want to work in frontline. So when the person is already, we can test and positive an antibody, and then we can make that person to work in frontline, particularly in healthcare setting, as Varagunan said, healthcare setting, even in the care homes. So then they won't transmit and they won't get the virus. So then they can work minimum protective equipments.
Again, we need to be very cautious about these antibody testing, because there can be antibodies to one strain. It's like the influenza. But yes, this person could be infected with another strain. So there is something called mutation. I mean, the non-medical people, the medical people. Mutation means this virus changes into different forms. This is like the Surendirakumar. Suddenly there is a, what do you call, serval veruver suran irunda pole mam mamarama veruver irunda pole innoru aattu thaliyoda veruver suran por madri in the virus is like the suran. It is changing. So this person might have antibodies to one particular strain, but he can be get infected the other strain. So it is still in very early stage that scientific knowledge is very, very primitive here. I just want to quickly shift the gear to the treatment part of it. We are hearing lots of treatment. You know, initially, our lovely president down south, respectable Donald Trump, said hydroxychloroquine. This is the answer. But now, hydroxychloroquine, they have proved by research that it is useless. And it can kill by side effects. If you take hydroxychloroquine, and if you have some arrhythmias in your heart, then you definitely get into trouble. So that is gone. Now there is another drug being touted, the antiviral drug called remdesivir. So remdesivir, they did a small trial in New York, and that is, they say, hey, they jumped and said, hey, it looks promising. But if you look at the studies, if I read the study, it actually given IV, it can't be taken by a tablet or a capsule. it has to be given in a hospital setting. Number three is, what it does is, rather than waiting 15 days in the hospital, you are discharged in 11 days. So it shortens the period of hospital stay. It doesn't completely cure it. But they say it can be given, especially in dire situations like in the US, 66,000 people died. Yes, try it out, and some of them can be reversed of this effect. So remdesivir is promising, but that is not the answer yet. Same thing with Tamiflu. We give it for the influenza. That can shorten the period of the illness. That can shorten, but it doesn't kill the virus right away. So we are still in early stage. That is my humble opinion. Anybody else want to jump in here?
Dr. Varagunan.
Yes. Go ahead, sir.
No. I think that's a point that that's why this very we are very keen in Sri Lanka that compare this health system and then make this. It's better to make the people to take at most precaution measures to avoid this getting the virus. So that there are only few cases actually were kept in ICU. I think currently only one case in ICU for this COVID-19 in Sri Lanka. So rest of the cases just kept in the hospital, IDH hospital, because that we detect people in very early. That's why that you ask, that out of even 700, only 7 deaths. So a lot of people were asking, so why that, how that is possible? Because these people, viral load also very, very low. So then most of the people are recovering from this normal ward. So 3 days back, there was a presentation by Sri Lanka Medical Association and Asian Pacific Academy Concerning Public Health. So our senior physician that in charge of infectious disease, Dr. Ananda said, so that his things are available in the Daily Mirror also that they published. So about these details. So in Sri Lanka, but still we are using hydroxychloroquine. But as Dr. Varagunan said, main problem is people should be educated how these drugs and vaccines are really developed in the world. So it's not a simple overnight process. So usually when we want to bring this drug into the market, usually it takes 6 to 7 years, 6 to 8 years. But even then, if we want to bring that in very quickly with the minimum period, at least we need 2 years, 1.5 to 2 years. So unfortunately, even this president of a big country also didn't get enough advice and talking that virus is coming, drug is coming, and all these things, it's not possible. So even after getting the vaccine, as Dr. Varagunan said, this virus get mutation. So I don't know how effective that vaccine is going to, or even when we get this antiviral, like influenza, we have Tamiflu. But it's still that every season we get the influenza. So it's only way that we have to go to the precaution. And I don't know whether Varagunan, I have invited some of these EHS people and Iswara Mohan also available. I don't know, they left. That actually talk something, but we can do some innovation for the people to support this because we know this, we are not going to get any vaccine or treatment. So then we need to have some preventive aspects, actually personal protection equipment and then the soap and sanitizers and all these things in affordable cost. Mm-hmm. So any possible way, and also we need to
there are a few initiatives in the University of Jaffna. So we need real support for them to get. So if the time permit, then please include that. And then they can
Doctor,
tell
that
what they
Mohan
are doing.
Yes, Dr. Isra Mohan. Good to see you.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. So also I agree mostly with Dr. Surendirakumar. So as far as Sri Lanka, as far as northern province, the only way it's a precaution. So because we have, when comparing other countries, we have limited resources and limited facilities in all over the sectors. So I believe the precaution is the only answer for us, rather than social spreading, rather than allowing them into the social spreading and try to treatment protocol, it will be not answerable. But thank you very much giving chance for me, because I have been serving as a director for University Business Linkage. So we are very happy, and we have introduced many supportive grants, small scale grants by nationally. They have announced for grant support for the COVID-19, as well as there are some other interested people, interested association. They accepted to donate something for developing prototypes to control these kind of precautions, like producing mask and reusable mask and preparing very effective sanitizer with the low cost, because our people, even you know, as Varagunan mentioned, so we have economically poor people. They are facing many problems. Even using soaps, in Sri Lankan currency, it comes 65 rupees. Because I had experience in many families complaining that they are missing soaps. Even the crow, they carry the soaps and it put everywhere. So they are losing their economy and their day-to-day, they are expecting. So, but soap, even the soap is the problem for them. So we have to think about how we could overcome these problems by introducing prototypes. So I welcome all the faculty members, university academics and the students. Do the relevant research as far as to promote this reusable mask, reusable facial mask and those things. So I can see even Balluan also here. So engineering faculty, so they have been developing many ideas. So I'm sure so many things will come out. And so Dr. Surendirakumar also involved in kind of IT, because there are poor service in IT communication as far as the getting the goods. So like a Pygmy, like other Uber, like resources are limited our places. So those things also should be, even pharmacy item also should be very quick, because as country imposed the curfew, we are supporting and we have been obeying those rules, because it's the only option for us to precautions rather than spreading all of the social. So as much as possible, the publics, they have been observing, they are at home, they work from home. However, there are the middle class and the people who are below the poverty lines, so who has been facing a lot. So I welcome through our website and through our many forums, so university academic and students. And also, I welcome other entrepreneurs who could who could join us in a different ideas. And so we have resources, so we will be able to come up with novel findings, and it will be helpful just to minimize certain spreading. That's I believe. Thank you very much.
Excellent, Doctor.
Please, and I'm yes. Doctor Surendran. I understand that the virus is temperature sensitive. So if we can introduce in our lifestyle, like brushing your teeth, to gargle with hot water, inhalations, I think a lot of people are doing that. Is that of any use? Is that a myth, or is something that we should adopt? A useful, simple strategy.
So
the people... Like, and, Why can't you ask this question to Professor Manoj also there, Vikram Singh, University of Colombo, I think he...
Dr. Manoj Vikram Singh, do you want to answer this question, please? Dr. Manoj?
Manoj, I think he left, I think. No?
Okay. It's a great question, Mrs. Wilson. Saltwater gargling, hot water. I mean, they're not been proved to eliminate these viruses. The moment virus get to your mucous membrane, it penetrates and goes inside your system. It's not going to wait for the hot water to come in and thing. But generally, like saltwater gargling and all, these things can actually prevent secondary infections like bacterial infections. And it actually gets the body a good resistant power than killing the virus itself. Do I sound okay, Dr. Surendirakumar?
Yeah, exactly. You are right. That's why that people are trying, but that it won't work because, as you correctly said, it actually penetrate and get into this attach. So it won't work like what we do, this common taking that steam inhalation and all these things. So, but that it will help us that improve our oral and nasopharyngeal hygiene. So in a way that is improving our immunity level.
When we brush our teeth 3 or 4 times a day, and the oral hygiene gets improved, and we don't get any infection bacteria. When an infection sets in, like bacteria, our body resistant power goes down, and these viruses can act more. So, improving general health definitely improves. So, these are good measures, but they're not directly linked to the virus. That's my 2 cents. We have an Ayurvedic practitioner here. We would like to get her comment here. I think, Doc, is this... So, this is Nirmala Srivimala. Is Nirmala Srivimala here? I think she must have left. Oh, no, she's here.
No, she's there. She should be there. She hasn't said she has left.
Yeah, so I think her... The microphone is mute and her video is mute. So is Nirmala Srivimala, you can actually give your comments on Ayurveda medicine. I mean, these are great strengths we have, our Sri Lankan Indian culture, Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani. But unfortunately, these medicines are not tested at the right time and not proven according to the science. Sometimes you cannot compare these things to the Western medicine, but there could be an answer in Ayurveda. We don't know. There could be an answer in Siddha medicine. Unfortunately, the people who are claiming to have answers have no knowledge, or they are fraudulent. And those people who have knowledge are not coming out. So we need proper indigenous medicine people to come out and show us, hey, this can be done. This is the mechanism. That dialogue needs to come out. Anybody object this?
I think the Industrial Technology Institute, in fact, I spoke to the chairman, Dr. Sirimal Premakumar, the other day, and also to Dr. Chandima Abhay Sirivadana. He actually is has an Ayurvedic background, plus he has Western qualifications as well, and they are looking at traditional methods and trying to prove scientifically that to see that, because they say they have some formulations and they are looking at it at the moment, some traditional fusions and things like that. So there is a group that's working quite actively right now.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Yes, Renuka.
Thank you. Just people in Jaffna. I was just wondering, there are lots of radio, commentaries on the radio for public health. and they were very, actually very good, the Tamil radio items. I was just wondering if that's a way that you're actually reaching people in the villages and so on, about what's happening and, for example, what type of masks to use, because everyone's wearing a mask, but whether the quality is suitable, just to give advice. The second thing is, there seems to be a lot of, what's the word to use, to victimizing people who have COVID. And so, for example, they're either, you know, minorities, or they're poor people, or they're drug addicts. That's the sort of thing you see in the newspapers. And I'm just wondering whether, because of that, people who actually have symptoms will come to the hospitals, and so kind of be, so that you are aware of who actually has got the infection, and whether there needs to be some sort of education for to make encourage people to come to hospitals, and that they won't be sort of stigmatized if they have COVID.
Great, yeah. Great comment. Yes, Surendran.
No, that stigmatization is the problem, and even that we had the Jaffna Medical Association Zoom meeting 2 months back, 2 weeks back, when Dr. Kesavan, our public health consultant, was, we were discussing about that. And also that you would have heard about that day before yesterday, there were two deaths from two old gentlemen, yeah, gentlemen from Kesalwat, and two died because of their all in 80 plus, and due to their non-communicable diseases, but they were poor, and then street beggars, and then they were community people were resisting them not to do the cremation in Mulathi when taken to another place. So like that, there are problems in our community. But then, as you said, that we are doing to radio, even newspaper and television. The television, we have problem because the most of these people in northern province are using that cable channel or disc TV, and most of the channels are international, and then watch most of these drama and film from India, Tamil Nadu. So then very difficult for us to reach our people, even when we want to give proper health education, except some of these local channels now operating a few good channels. So we are using that as much as possible, and different people to educate the public. So, but still we have a stigma. But at the same time, that's what that, you know, then Sri Lanka was very successful till we get 240 cases. But after that, the number has increased because of this, particularly these Navy officers were that going behind with this, with our health department people to get to truck addicts that to infected with the COVID-19. So then when we were tracing that, we were able to find out. So then they got the infection from them. So when they were handling them, then they never thought that they will contacted with this. That's the problem. And then they went out, and then they were living in the camp, and then from there, then it spread out all over the places. So then there are risks. And also, as you said, it's a very tough task, and still we didn't check that. We get, but some of the cases now, you know, even some of these people affected with the mental illness also, maybe this, they are on the street. So we frequently get that kind of patients ended up in hospitals. So most of the people, they inform us, then they take or inform us or take them to the hospital. So we check most of the people, well, all testing. So see that whether they have a COVID-19 or not. So it's very tough, but we have to tackle that and handle it. Mm-hmm. And then Dr. Varagunan, if this permitted, and there Siva Sintuja, that the pharmacy, they are starting some of the thing about hand sanitizer, their initiative, and Valvan is from...
Absolutely. Go ahead. Yes, yeah. Please. I think we have Yoga Varadhan. We have another 15 minutes to go.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, I can go on all day, but I think it's already 2 hours have elapsed.
So, these two people to explain what their initiatives, and then this forum can help them to find out enough support to develop some local products.
Absolutely.
So,
can I ask you a question, please?
Yes, Didi, go ahead.
This I am an entrepreneur. As I mentioned, I have factories, and I hope to start work around on the 4th. Of course, I'm just doing a dummy run, but by the 11th, we hope to start our production lines. Now, what I like to share from this eminent group is, what is the best advice you will give when you start a thing with fear psychosis among the workforce? You see, that naturally we are all human. In fact, I am worried. I also don't know how we can this thing, but we have to get the economy going. We have to produce. We have to export our things. The orders have come for us. But then we have to produce our rice to the market. So on and so forth. How does Canada, are they started their production as normal, or how does it go? Do you start with 50% or 30%, or realign the processes? Just can I have some advice from the eminent forum?
Yeah, great question. I will actually be very short. So Canada, we completely listen to the medical professionals and scientists. We don't actually take political decisions or engineering decisions or military decisions to implement or opening up anything. It's purely medical and scientific fraternity which advises the government, and they. So from Monday, we are going to start in my province. So every province is different. We have about 9 provinces. So every province has different cases and different death rates. And every province have different factories, different entrepreneurship, everything. So in Ontario, where I live, May 4th, they are relaxing certain rules step by step. So the factories are allowed to start, some of the factories where there is no close contact. So the factories have been strictly advised that you have to be 8 feet apart between 2 workers. Mm-hmm. And then they are starting the golf courses on one side to prepare, not to allow public. And they are starting slowly the economy, very slowly. After this week, 2 weeks, they will reassess, then relax little by little. They are not in a hurry. And the public health is working tirelessly to advise the government and the premier and the chief minister, everybody, what exactly to do next. If they find something going on, they will shut it down immediately. So there is no question about. So the life becomes first, then becomes economy. That could be good for Canada, because Canada is a well-to-do country, and nobody is starving here without food. It could be different in Sri Lanka, which I'm unable to comment here. Maybe, you know, one of you, Dr. Surendran, can comment on that.
Now they said, Yafna, I my experience is actually, we are working in the northern province. Here in province, we meet every day that our provincial coordination committee under the leadership of provincial director of health service. So we also assess, and then we give the advice. But some of the things that come from central, no, then decisions, particularly this curfew and all things. So then to work. But still actually markets are open, that wholesale market, even Dumbler, Manning Place and all these things. But in Jaffna, still we have not opened. Even Tinnavelli, Marlana Madam and all, still then there are issues, but we have not opened, because we know that it's very difficult to maintain the, so as Dr. Varagunan said, there's a social distancing. So it's a issue. Even then, now we are working to open the university. So the peers, fear psychosis is really a problem, but then we need to assure them. So then we have to get people step by step. So then you can see then which is minimum risk to start. And then we have to give the assurance for the people those are coming also. It's a safe place. So then we have to go there first as top level officials and managers to be there with all the adequate precautions. And then we have to find out at least health team in the place to do this. We have to ask environmental sanitation and surveillance. So we have to see how to use this personal protective equipment and all these things. So they need a clear instruction things. But there are work guide and all these things available. But that is it won't work without proper advice. So then there is a need for getting the medical or health input. So then it's good to get this area MOH or public health inspector with you, and then they can help you that to start this kind of thing. But then later on, couple of your staff to handle this situation. So that's the way, step by step, and you can start maybe admin block first, and then go to the this sales section. So like that I am not a very good. I also don't have your way that the setting. So that's the way that the setting can start. So start with a small number, and then week by week, and see the situation. And then particularly the situation around the area is very important. So then some of the area is very risky. So then that area, maybe you can think about, even that we were discussing about opening of universities. So initially we thought to start some of the things in the periphery, then to go to the high-risk places like Colombo, Gambaga, and all these places. So same kind of approach you can also adapt and then get into that kind of thing.
So, Mr. D,
can I comment, Doctor? My name is Vasu. I joined it later. I just want to comment that about two days ago, I came from Jaffna to... Hello?
Vasu, you go ahead, Vasu.
Yeah. About 2 days ago, three days ago, I came from Jaffna to Uwa province. I got special pass and came towards Uwa province. What we see is only within Jaffna, up to Vavaniya, the checkings are very severe and they are controlling very severe. Past Vavaniya, the life is back to normal, you know. The factories are functioning, markets are functioning, and supermarkets are functioning. People are moving around. Only for the curfew, they are strict. But the life has come back normal. They identify five different areas, plus Jaffna. These areas are considered danger zones, and then whoever coming from there, they are treated differently. And as the other gentleman said, he wants to open the factory. If you can check the area, it's best to check the area, whether the area is relaxed there or not. Because when I came to Haldamulla, the Uwa province, when I went in, we had to report to the MOH. When I reported to the MOH, as soon as he heard, oh, I come from Jaffna, he said, please, you have to self-quarantine 2 more weeks. It doesn't matter. It's okay. It's all okay. But if you want to start the business, please check the area-wise. So some areas, they are relaxing. Some areas, they are still controlling because they suspect some cases are there. So it's best, as the doctor said, to check the area. They check the area where he's going to start the factory. And that's the best way of going about.
Great. Thank you so much. Mr. Didi, I would actually add something here. If I am your factory worker, I'm thinking that way. See, I'm working in your factory. I have a very poor family. I have an elderly father. I have a big family to support. I'm not getting any money, but I'm worried about the COVID-19. I am actually getting into the mind of the worker. Now I come to the factory, I see my mudalali there. He is with the factory workers. That is one reassuring. Number two is education. Getting positive of COVID-19 is not the death sentence. You can die of car accident or any other causes than COVID-19. So that education needs to be, a reassurance needs to be done. Even if you get positive, not every COVID positive patient gets symptomatic, or not every COVID patient gets admitted to the ICU. And you can actually hug the COVID patient and all that after they become all right. So as Mudalali, I'm sorry for the local language, as my boss, you know, you have to give them education. Look here, even if you get sick, even if you are admitted, my company will take care of you. My company will take care of your whole family. Come over. I'm here to help you. That is the attitude Canadian government is giving you. So you apply today, you're unemployed. Next, tomorrow, your bank account is given $2,000. That same approach. I'm not trying to boast what we do here. It's so different. But I think you need to set an example, and more education is needed. I think the whole Sri Lanka needs more education. Sri Lanka and India, they are getting it. But there are lots of conspiracy theories. Somebody said they are trying to destroy the whole Jaffna. That is all you know, nonsense. So these conspiracy theories needs to be dispelled. So that is my two cents. Sorry if I said anything wrong.
Thank you.
Thank you. Some valuable insights. But only thing is, an infected person, if he goes back home, he will be transmitting it. So all sorts of precaution should be there in place, is my belief.
Yes.
Two, in the UK, what they will bring. Yeah, in the UK, what they will bring is, they're not yet brought in for the factories, but 2 meters apart, the protective gear, hand wash at all entry points and few, lots of different points, the hand cleanliness, canteens to be also maintained, so that there will be 2 meters apart with guards to separate people, safeguarding with the separation things, and also looking at motion studies, how it is creativity there. How you can devise your motion to optimize your production at the same time getting the space into place.
Excellent.
Thank you. So
let me sum up, give you a summary, and then I think we all have to leave here.
So follow up on one point Dr. Surendirakumar and Dr. Isruman said. So I am Valluan, so I am from the Faculty of Engineering Institute, Jaffna. And so at that moment, actually, so we are working together with the Clean Out Hospital and the Health Provincial Health Department, and closely with the other engineering faculties as well. So some a team of academics and some collaborating doctors and health professionals together with Dr. Surendirakumar, who is helping us a lot. So we are actually working on designing PPEs, and actually kind of the idea is to increase the local capacity if there's a big breakout. So because the issue is the supply chain, because even with whatever we are doing, actually we are designing, improving the existing design, because we started with some openly available architectures and designs. So then we improved, tested. So we are now making reusable face shields, and trying to optimize or effectively utilize the filter material for N95 masks. So we are designing them, printing them in 3D printers, doing the laser cutting. And so we are in the process of also making robots, designing robots, which can actually man the floor of the isolation boards. And so there are many being carried out at the moment. One of the key challenges that we have is actually getting the proper materials, like the supply chain is the issue. So, for example, there's a team which is actually working on ventilators, but they cannot access sensors because you cannot bring in sensors from outside because of all these restrictions and other things. And it's now a very, a sensor which costs a small amount now costs a big amount because we had to pay for special couriers to bring them in. And if anybody who wants actually to work with us, and support us in this endeavor, because the idea is to increase the local capacity and the emergency preparedness. So it helps us in many ways. So actually, this group has organically grown by itself. So we started with some small things and then kind of added the professionals in, and now it's actually producing new good results, because by Monday we'll be delivering around 100 face shields, which is developed at the Faculty of Engineering. And so we found a supplier who can give us those raw materials, and now it's being now laser cut in the northern region, and it'll be handed over to the Klinochi Hospital. So we actually, the hard work is producing results, but it needs more support from the community and the professionals around the world as well, because especially at this situation, we have somebody who can actually help us bring in some sensors and other things. Please kindly, or any other aids or helps they can actually make, you can contact us through Dr. Isomon. He's the director of UBL, so it's essentially to connect the university to the outside world, or the public or private, or all the entities. So you can either contact three of us. And if you have an interest to work with us, we are always welcoming new ideas and innovative process into this. So that's what I have to say.
Hello. Thank you so much. Hello. Very, very inspirational. And the you know, work you're doing is excellent and exceptional. Thank you so much.
I need to make a small comment. Is it okay?
Yes, go ahead, please.
Yeah, my name is Kaushal Rajapaksa. I'm the president of Plastics and Rubbish of Sri Lanka. Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was listening all this time for this conversation and the dialogue between doctors, and I really appreciate. And it is quite good. And we in our institute, as a president, we provide education for the plastics and rubber industry staff, employees. So according to what Mr. Veluan said, we are also involved in doing national projects. We were involved in developing the first ICU bed in Sri Lanka. And we have our finite and simulation and analysis center in set up with the government. So whatever the support that we can do, we could help whatever the way. And also I like to have a dialogue with the university, because we are connected with the universities in South, in Colombo, so that see how best we could exchange our resources and knowledge to help the industry, to help the the North to do these PPE equipments. And also I like to communicate with the entrepreneur who said, because I'm my industry is mostly based in recycling of waste, plastics and rubber, and we have started our factory. So I like to impart my experience as to how we started the factories. Later on, I'm thankful for Niranjan for connecting me with this group, so that we can take this forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Mr. Rajapaksa. It was amazing. And we should really thank Niranjan. I mean, he's a good resource for coordinating all the efforts.
Yes.
At the final remark I would like to make, because I think everybody is busy. You know what? It's time. It's going to change the world. Like 9/11 attack in New York changed the whole travel industry. It's going to change how we're going to live again from 2020, and I think it's time to think about the lower trodden masses, the poor people, you know, the people living in up countries, the tea pluckers, and the people who are living in South, Hammadgata fishermen, people living in Jaffna who are affected by wars. These are all our brothers Sri Lankans. I think I'm not making a political statement, but it's coming from my heart. We need to raise their standard of living. I think that's the best way to educate people. And going forward, Sri Lanka could be the number one country in that region, even in the world. I'm a proud Sri Lankan living in Canada. But that is the only way. Forget the differences. You know, we think one Sri Lankan, and it can be, you can be from South, North or East. We don't care. It's Sri Lanka. And we need to lift these masses upward. That should be our motto from now onwards. not
exactly,
a political
exactly.
But coming from heart.
Thank you. Very happy to hear this. Thank
hi,
you very much.
Hello, hi, this is Sivasanduja. Yeah. I would like to give some note regarding the hand sanitizer as Dr. Surendirakumar said earlier. So we are going to work regarding the hand sanitizer preparation. Dr. Surendirakumar introduced a person. He's a small entrepreneur. He's having the alcohol, but he prepared from the toddy. That is, he told that he most probably it is going to have 80% of alcohol, but still I'm not sure about that. For that, we are going to measure the initial alcohol percentage, and also we have to ensure that there's no microbial contamination. So we are going to start that one. For that, we need the alcohol meter. So currently we are having the normal laboratory alcohol meter. So if we could get a digital alcohol meter, it might be helpful, because in the toddy sample, it is possibly having the more sugar. It might interrupt the alcohol measurement using the normal alcohol meter. So we are looking forward to buy that one also. And another thing is, if we couldn't make it through this sample, we are planning to do the normal WHO standard hand sanitizer. It might, through that we can help our society. So for that, we need some funding, because it is not an innovation. So that's the main drawback. But even though we can help to our society. So if anybody can help to give some funding or any knowledge sharing, it would be helpful to us. Because as a growing faculty of HS, it might be helpful, and we can get some enthusiasm to get start these kind of works. Thank you.
Excellent. I think Niranjan, it's up to you. You know, you have to coordinate all these professionals. We have great discussion today.
Yes, Dr. Varagunan, I think finally you can give a chance those who are very much interested to talk about this COVID-19 and waiting for a chance. Give them at least two minutes.
The forum is open. So forum is open.
Can I ask something, Dr. Varel, all your doctors? In the UK, they think the BME population, including the Asians, are more susceptible to this disease. They don't know why, but the information, their statistics is showing that. What are your thoughts? And it's very great to hear that Sri Lanka doesn't have that much.
What is BME? I mean,
the black minority, and also the Asians, the Southeast Asians in public.
So, I mean, I'm not able to comment on UK, but these are the poverty. If you see the BME people, they go below the poverty line. So, poverty is a big factor in the US, and I'm not sure about the UK, because there are like health insurance play a part, and you know, there are lots of factors play a part. Their housing play a part, their joblessness, you know, so many factors play a part.
Because, they recognize this, because they know that about 50%, more than 50% of doctors are Asians. They know that, they recognize that. And so, and these people are very affluent people, but it's more, they're more prone to than is what they're trying to.
We don't know whether there is any genetic, maybe coming years we may know some answers, we may not know the answers, so we don't know.
Most of the time they propose no, then related to the vitamin D and all these things, but maybe that our living standard and things also, as Varagunan said, but there are a couple of things are coming out that related to vitamin D. But as we said, we don't know exactly this virus. The knowledge about the virus is only 3 months. We need to study more. So we need to get more information and scientific evidences.
Oh, thank you. Thanks.
Yeah, one final comment is from me, Lasanth Mendes from Colombo. The gentleman who spoke to from Jaffna asking for some assistance, I think Mr. Valuvanan and
Shiva Sinduja,
Yajeshwaran Mohan, right? Doctor, please get in touch with me. I have put my telephone number, and whatever assistance you want and whatever we can do, we will definitely do, right? Because this is an opportunity which we would also like to get involved in helping the North. So please, you know, anybody else also, whatever, you know, you want assistance from the South, please contact me. I have put my telephone number also on the chat. My name is Lasantha Mendes, and we'll be very happy to help out, because I come to Jaffna once a month, you know, so I can definitely link up with you. Thank you very much, and thank you, Dr. Varagunan and Niranjan, for this opportunity.
Very much appreciated, Mr. Rajapaksa. Thank you so much. Anyone else want to jump in and give a comment or question or a...
Yeah, I want to make a correction. Yeah. That was Lasantha Mendes who spoke a little while ago.
Sorry, Mr. Yeah. Mendes. Sorry.
Thank you, Governor. Thank you.
I want to make a small comment also. Go ahead.
Rajapaksa, carry on.
I would like to add some more points. This is not entrepreneur skills. This is other than this human to human transmission. I am worrying about the whistleware cost. It was believed from China and various countries as the bats and the ant and some other animals. So is it possible to human to animal transmission, and it could go on as a dengue or other virus cases in future? So the animals could be as a reservoir cost for transmission of this virus. So that will be a big question in front of us. So do you have any idea on this in future?
Good question. I think so far good news is it's not spread through the animals yet. So even yesterday there was a research study result say pets getting infected. I think there was a dog was positive for COVID-19, but they found it is not it's not spreading from animal to human right now. But thank goodness we don't eat bats in Sri Lanka, so that's good news.
Animal the human to animal. So most of the pandemic experience didn't. We don't have that kind of thing. So particularly, you know, these wild animal and domestic animals. So the domestic animals, I don't know that you may know better in that. And they have a different kind of thing compared to the wild animals. So most of these mutation and transmission, when we human has more contact with the wild animals, even, you know, this rabies also same thing, no? Then our domestic dogs get the rabies virus from the wild animals. So that that transmission most of the time, that direction is more than the other way around, no? So that is the usual pattern. So, but we don't know how will this behave. So that is also, it is good to have a surveillance, the vigilance to testing these animals. Mm.
I would like to thank Niranjan. Niranjan, you have been immense support. You have contacted various platforms over the course of time, and thank you very much. And I hope you carry on doing that.
Final remark I want to make. I'm the president of the IMHO Canada. We've been doing a lot of work in Sri Lanka. I was in Sri Lanka. Got off at the right time. March 15th, I flew back. So if you guys need any help by resource or anything, you know, feel free to contact us. You know, we have done, currently we are doing the palliative care, home-based palliative care projects in two districts in Jaffna and Bavunia, which is very successful. So feel free to contact me. I can put my contacts here, or Niranjan has my number. So thank you so much. If we don't have any other comments or anything, we can definitely meet in the future. I mean, it's a great forum. We can definitely meet in another Sunday evening, if that's okay. Probably 2 weeks from now or 10 days from now, we'll have more good information. Niranjan and Yoga Varadhan, Marimahan, you guys, amazing, amazing.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Doctor. I'm very happy to hear this. I want to talk about because we are connected to the Lions International Organization, and the gentleman who spoke a little while ago, Mendes. Yeah, he's Lasanta. He's also a lion. And we cover this area of Jaffna, different the whole of Sri Lanka. So whatever the things that we can do to help the country, we are there through Lions. And also I got to know Ranjan, especially because I am the vice president of the newly formed organization called COSME, Confederation for Small and Medium Scale Industries. We are helping the industry. So there are a lot of ways that we can have interaction, get to know the latest technologies and all that through COVID, battling the COVID pandemic. And let's move forward. As you said, we could meet in the 2 weeks' time. I think Niranjan will organize this. And I thank you, Niranjan, for this excellent opportunity. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much, everyone. I think it's time to go to bed for you guys. And for us, it's time to have lunch here. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Varagunan and Dr. Surendran. Both of you gave some lot of information and how to control the COVID and all. So thank you very much for your time spent in this webinar. And as everyone is willing to continue, let us continue. So thank you for the initiative by Yoga Varadhan and Mirai. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you all on behalf of
good night.
Thank you very much.
Good night.
For yourself.